and welcome to worship. And all of you that are with us today for the baptism, welcome. We're glad to have you here. We'll be celebrating communion as part of our worship today. And so you're all welcome to come forward, receive the bread and wine, the body and blood of Christ. We serve by coming to the center aisle, coming forward. You receive a bread or a wafer, and then you take a cup, eat and drink, and you place the cup in these trays on your way back to your place. I have a couple of things I want to draw your attention to as we get started for worship this morning. First of all, we are going to have an entry in the parade for the Heimatfest coming up next weekend. We still need a little bit of help, and if you're willing to do that, Clint, would you wave? Talk with Clint after church today, and or there is also a sign-up through the church office. You can do that online. And then the other thing that I wanted to do was call on Deb Anderson this morning. She's got an announcement.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Shar. Happy birthday to you.
Oh, Shar, you are an opportunist. Well, there are some other announcements. Make yourself aware of what's coming up in the life of our congregation. And with that, if you're comfortable turning to other people that are with you and around you, welcome each other to worship. Stand, welcome each other to worship, and then remain standing. Can light them now. I invite you to stand back up as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. For our baptism today, we gather for worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, yesterday's, today's, and tomorrow's. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please remain standing.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has broken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them fresh from the word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Kyrie. To God in the highest. and peace to God's people on earth. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God, glory to God, and peace to God's people on earth. And peace to God's people on earth.
Please join me in prayer. O God, judge eternal, you love justice and hate oppression, and you call us to share your zeal for truth. Give us courage to take our stand with all victims of bloodshed and greed, and following your servants and prophets, to look to the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The congregation may be seated, and would the baptismal party please come forward and stand here behind the baptismal font, facing the congregation. Luca, are we going to get some water on your head? Huh? We're going to. All right. I am going to light this and give this to you. And you can hold that. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. Who presents this child to receive the sacrament of holy baptism? All of you do. You know what? I think you might want a copy of that right there. As you bring Luca to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with some responsibilities. To live with him among God's faithful people, bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed and the Ten Commandments, and place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture him in faith and prayer so that Luca may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world that God has made, and to work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Luca grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, respond with, we do. People of God, do you promise to support Luca and pray for him in his new life in Christ? If so, respond with, we do. Now I ask all of you, congregation, sponsors, baptismal party, to join as we confess our Christian faith. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you away from God? If so, respond with, we do. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Would you lean Luca over the baptismal font? Okay, I'm going to dump some water on your head now. Are you ready? Luca, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Here we go. Would all of you gather around and we will place a hand somewhere on Luca's shoulder or head and we will pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give your daughters and sons new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Luca with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Luca, child of God, you have been marked with the cross of Christ and sealed by the Holy Spirit forever. Let your light so shine before all people that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Amen. Now, I invite all of you to join me in welcoming Luca into God's family and into our Hope family. We welcome you into the body of Christ and the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to the world. Amen. And now, with a round of applause. And you can blow that out if you'd like. There you go. And you may go back to your places. We'll continue with the scripture readings for the day.
The first reading for the day is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30. See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God and listen to his voice and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The second reading is Paul's letter to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend, and fellow worker, also to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace and peace to you from our God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all his holy people and your faith in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the Lord's people. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as none other than Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, that I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do would not seem forced, but would be voluntary. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I ask. Here ends the lesson.
Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? Alleluia, you have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia.
Our gospel reading for today is from Luke chapter 14. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and wasn't able to finish. Or suppose a king who is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he's able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000. If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have, cannot be my disciples." The gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. So today, in this passage of Scripture and other Scripture writers in the other two passages of Scripture that we read for today, are all talking about the cost of following Jesus, the cost of discipleship. So this Luke text starts out with a large crowd was gathering around him or traveling with him. A large crowd of people, lots of people, and it suggests that they were following him from town to town across the countryside. They were following Jesus. And Jesus sort of took a time out in this passage of Scripture to ask them to consider the cost of following him. Hey, before you follow me, before you say you're going to commit everything to me, take a moment and think it through. I think that's what Jesus is talking about. The cost of discipleship. All of the passages talk about that. The first one, choose this day whom you're going to serve. Make a choice and then serve that one. And the second one, Paul, all sorts of instructions there for us to about what it means to follow Christ. But you know what I think probably jumps out at most of us, caught our attention, is not so much the cost of discipleship, but that word hate, right? Unless you hate your father, mother, brother, sister, what all the different family members that were listed, unless you hate them, you cannot follow. You cannot be my disciple. Well, like so many words in the Bible, you have to put that word hate into the right context because the context defines how that word is supposed to be used. So actually, the Greek word is the word miso, or a word that we use, you know, so often our English words are a combination of a couple, two different Greek words or Latin words or something like that. So this word miso that's translated hate is actually the beginning of a word that we hear a lot in our culture today, misogynist. It's the same word. And so some people might call a misogynist a woman hater. That's one way some people define it. But it could probably be argued that a misogynist doesn't necessarily hate a woman, but certainly is unaware of how they treat the woman, or at least mistreat. So miso, it depends on the context you put it in. It can be hate. It could be translated misogynist as a woman hater, but many of us could argue that it is just some people being totally unaware of how they're treating a woman. And it may not actually use that or have that intention or that emotion of hate attached. It's the same with this text for today. Miso can be translated hate. It's kind of like the word dinosaur. Pastor Ted is a dinosaur. That doesn't mean Pastor Ted is actually one of those creatures, but in our context, it probably means he's old school. He got educated to be a pastor 30-some years ago. He's old-fashioned. If you were to say Pastor Ted's a dinosaur, you mean that. And you may mean my ways or my approach to being a pastor is just about extinct. But you don't mean I'm literally a dinosaur. And so it's the same with this word here, miso. It's really in this context about priority and the cost of discipleship. Priority and the cost of discipleship. And what Jesus is saying to all of those crowds that are following, all of those people that think they're following, and Jesus says, wait a minute, think it through. Can you really pay the cost that's included in this? He's talking about family and our relationships, and that we put Christ ahead of everything else in life. Not just our father or mother or sister or brother, but everything in life. And so really this passage of Scripture isn't about necessarily hating your family. It's about following Jesus and what that means, what it's going to cost you and me to follow Jesus faithfully throughout this life. It's about priority and making Jesus number one in our life. And so, now, with this being Labor Day weekend, let me tie two things together. This whole idea of the cost, counting the cost of following Jesus, the cost of discipleship, and Labor Day weekend, or vocation. Now, I'm going to talk about vocation theologically, not like in the secular sense, or not just the general sense, meaning your job. But you have a vocation, whether you are an elementary student, or you're retired, or you're unemployed, you have a vocation. I have a vocation, several of them. I'm a pastor. That's part of my vocation. That's my job. But I'm also, in the way that we use vocation in the church, it means a role that you play in life or a station you hold in life. So I'm a pastor, but I'm also a husband and a father. I'm a brother. I'm an uncle. I'm a friend. I'm a citizen. All of those are vocations or roles that I hold. What are yours? What's your vocation? If you notice the stuff that I talked about, it encompasses everything in life for me, doesn't it? Every single role I play. And I think that's what Jesus is getting at in this passage of Scripture. If you want to follow me, it's going to cost you everything. It's every single role you play in life. If you're retired and you don't have a job, you still got a vocation. You got several different roles. Every one of us have roles that we play. And the cost of discipleship is every one of those roles. Every one of those roles are a calling by God to follow Jesus. Every relationship we have, every role we play, every aspect of our job, if we are employed, is an invitation to follow Jesus faithfully. And what Jesus is saying in this passage of Scripture is following him will cost you everything. Everything. All we are, all we have. And so, those vocations, those roles you live out, those relationships, your job, your hobbies, your friends, every single aspect of life, every hour, every day, every week, every month, every year, is an invitation to follow Jesus faithfully. And every one of those places is a place to serve God and others. As a pastor, it's probably pretty obvious. But as a husband, as a father, as a brother, especially to that one brother that I get annoyed with, and you've got a few relationships like that as well, you know what? Every one of those is an invitation to follow Jesus faithfully. Every relationship. So let me insert this right here. Every single person that you've laid an eye on, every single person you've ever seen, is someone that Jesus died for. every single person you've ever laid eyes on is someone that Jesus died for. And every single person is an invitation to follow Jesus faithfully in this life. It's a place to serve God and others with our gifts and abilities. You've got gifts and abilities I don't have. God calls you to use yours, not mine, but use yours. The skills you've developed, the passions you have in life, that is an invitation to follow Jesus faithfully. Your time, your possessions, your motives, your intentions, all of those. In every one of those things, Jesus is inviting you to follow faithfully. Count the cost, he says in this passage of Scripture. Sit down and count the cost of what it really means to follow me. Now, he spoke it to those crowds that were walking with him that day, but it's you and me today. 2,000 years later, Jesus is saying the same thing to you and me. Come, follow me, and count the cost. It will cost you everything. So all of those roles that we play, I've said they're a place that we can serve God and others, but they are also a place for you and me to be transformed as disciples, to be literally changed. Because it's in all of those roles Jesus invites us to grow to be more like him. In every one of those roles that you play in life, all of them, you and I are confronted with our sin. There, in those roles, we're confronted with our failures. We're confronted with our flaws. We're confronted with our motives and our intentions in life. Aren't we? It's in those roles that all of that stuff we try to keep hidden is exposed. And Jesus invites us in the midst of that to be transformed, to be forgiven, and to be changed to be more like him. We can put up the walls, and we can fight it when we're confronted with all of those things that we want to hide. Or we can let it go at the foot of the cross, receive forgiveness, and ask Jesus to change us. So this passage of Scripture isn't about literally hating your family members. It's about putting Jesus first in every single aspect of life, every moment, every role, every situation and circumstance, considering it an opportunity to follow Jesus faithfully and to serve him and the world that God has created. And if you think that's a steep price to pay, think about what Jesus has paid for you and me. In a few moments, we'll receive communion, the bread and the wine. And as you come forward to take it, I invite you to reflect on what Jesus has done for you, brought to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin, and invites you to follow faithfully. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this call to follow you. In spite of who we are, in spite of all we know about ourselves, you call us to follow, to put it all down at the foot of the cross and follow you faithfully. And so, Jesus, we ask today that you would help us do that very thing. In your name we pray. Amen.
response to our prayers today to God of grace is, hear our prayer. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, for those in need, and for all of God's creation. We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. Refresh the hearts of your people. Deepen our understanding of every good thing we share. And strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, and for streams and other bodies of water, God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations and those in authority, for the elected leaders of our towns, states, and country, and for international organizations, grant wisdom to those who govern and raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of their neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, for those who struggle with homelessness or food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, and for all in this community who need your care in special ways, Claire, Destiny, Lynn, Lolly, and Joel, God of grace, hear our prayer. For this community of faith, for all our labors begun, continued, and ended in you, that they glorify your holy name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the saints who now rest from their labors. Find us faith like them to love you with all our hearts, and by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. God of grace, gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Hatred and blindness will be no more. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly.
Let us pray. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to the help of all in need through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen. We'll be celebrating communion now. All are invited to come forward and receive the bread and wine, the body and blood of Christ. Come to the center aisle. Come forward. Again, you'll receive bread or a wafer, and then take a cup, and you can eat and drink and place the cup in the rack on your way back to your chair. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We pray as Jesus taught the disciples, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, together on our knees. Let us drink wine together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy. Praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy. Thank you. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, I hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you in faith and keep you in faith to everlasting life. Amen. Please pray with me. God, our Creator, at this table, you have satisfied us with the good things of your grace. Fix our hearts on your mercy and truth, that our lives may reflect your love for all creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now continue to walk in Christ, rooted and built up in him. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Go in peace and welcome the stranger. Thanks be to God. Please stand for our closing hymn.
Let us ever walk with Jesus, follow his example pure, through a world that would deceive us and to sin our spirits lure. Onward in his footsteps treading, travelers here our home above, full of faith and and love. Let us do our Savior's bidding, faithful Lord, with me abide. I shall follow where you guide. Let us suffer here with Jesus and with patience bear our cross. Joy will follow all our sadness. Where he is, there is no loss. Though today we sow no laughter, we shall reap celestial joy. All discomforts that annoy shall give way to mirth hereafter. Jesus, here I share your woe. Help me there your joy to know. Let us gladly die with Jesus, since by death he conquered death. He will free us from destruction, give to us immortal breath. Let us mortify all passion that would lead us into sin. and the grave that shuts us in shall be let prove the gate of heaven. Jesus, here with you I die, there to live with you on high. Let us also live with Jesus. He has risen from the dead, that to life we may awaken. Jesus, you are now our head. We are your own living members. Where you live, there we shall be. In your presence constantly, living there with you forever. Jesus, let me faithful be, life eternal.